And please, I will ask you to make a warm applause for Albert. Thank you.
Thank you. That's too much credit. Didn't do anything and I all got an applause. Thank you. I hope it's worth it. More data, more questions. Observability. Who am I? I'm Albert Alberts. I work at KPN. I'm an architect, done several things within KPN. Developer, designer, architect, and I'm working on virtual private clouds, software-defined networking, and also the KPN API store. Well, I organize some meetups as well, and in my spare time I do some open water swimming, water polo, and cycling, and some other tech stuff like other geeks also do. Last year, I talked about the KPN API store, and this is more or less the image of the API store and all its elements at the back end. Not going to talk about this anymore. If you have more questions about it, feel free. I'm here after the talk. So it's about developer.kpn.com. That's where you can find the shop. And today we're going to talk about the next steps we did on the platform, namely the observability, because when you have your API, you also want to know how it performs. So I'm going to talk about observability. Some people say observability is a superset of monitoring. Certain benefits and insights, and monitoring tools that cannot deliver. It's kind of a point for discussion, I think. So what's monitoring, what's observability, if it's true or if it's not true. I'm not going into that discussion today. You can find lots of discussions about observability versus monitoring and what's what, but there are some interesting things to find. For instance, Cindy Sridharan, she wrote some really nice articles about observability, but she's also someone who changes her mind sometimes. And she mentioned in the very early beginning, she says, yeah, monitoring is just a different name for the same package. You say new wine in old bags, that's a kind of proverb. I'm not sure if it's in English translated well, but a lot of ways to look into it. A lot of people do agree about these three points, the three pillars of observability. It's metrics, it's logging, and it's tracing. And even there, people agree and disagree, and there's a variant four, where there's also alerting and visualization involved. So it's quite a wide area here. What it's all about is data and information, because you want information about your platform. The raw data is nothing, but you need that information there. And why do we need that information? Because we have SLAs. Everybody has SLAs. Is there anyone in the room who doesn't work with SLAs? It's awfully quiet. But you also have SLOs, service level objectives. Anyone of you using service level objectives? It's something that came out of the kitchen of Google, the site reliability engineering, where there are service level objectives, where you have your objective. That gives a kind of target where you as an operations department want to head to. So you always strive for 100%, but 100% is really expensive. So that's when you satisfy for 3/9, 4/9, whatever. And in the end, you have your service level indicator, and the indicator are actually the things you measure over time. And that's the metrics, the monitoring. And I see people taking pictures, but the slides will be available afterwards, so you can focus on the talk. So, monitoring. It's about known unknowns. This is kind of a nice quote, and actionable alerts. And I totally agree with this approach. It's for symptoms-based alerting, and that's also where the big difference is between observability and monitoring again. So your monitoring system should address two questions, what's broken and why. The what's broken indicates the system, the symptom, and the why indicates a possible cause. Yeah, that's always difficult, because you always have to interpret what happened in your system, and is this really the cause, or is it something caused by something else? It's a chain reaction, probably. the Site Reliability Engineering book. That's I think it's a kind of one. It's not a must read, but it's really interesting to read. And the books are free online available, so there's no reason not to dive into that. Observability is about unknown unknowns. And this is kind of almost philosophical. What's unknown unknown? Well, it's you don't know. Exactly. So, but it does empower you to ask new questions and ask questions yet to be formulated. So it's kind of a fluffy thing. You're measuring data, but you're not sure why you're measuring the data already, because you might need it afterwards. But it's also data that gives you insight in the system and lets you ask questions that you wouldn't have thought of before. So you see funny things happening in the system, in your metrics or in your dashboard. Hey, where is this coming from? And then you start asking questions. So I'm going to dive into some of the definitions here. Metrics, a raw measurement of resources, uses, or behavior that can be observed and collected over time. Yeah, so it's time-based, everything. And metrics is, again, the basic for monitoring. Monitoring the process of collecting, but also aggregating and analyzing those events. And it improves the awareness of components, characteristics, and behavior. It's a mouthful, but it gives you an idea where you stand with observability and monitoring here. And by the way, this is not one of the pillars. It's just an aggregation of one of the pillar data. And then you have your logging. A log is immutable, travels through the system, and handles discrete events, and almost always the same type of information. It has a timestamp, and it has something that happened on that time. And then we have tracing. And tracing is a different thing. Proved to be also the hardest thing to visualize and get into the system. It's a representation of data, seriously causally related, so it's different systems that have a relation with each other. And it's an end-to-end flow. Well, and try to get a nice image with that. So I took my open water swimming there. And that's in the lake where we traveled, where we swam across. But it gives it's a nice metaphor as well. It's from the green point at the beginning, all the way through the lake and to the end. But you know where I've been within the lake. And that's also with a systems call, an API call gets in, it's handled somewhere, moves a bit further, maybe calls even another API, and finally it returns a value, and then we're back at the point where we began. But you want to know what happened in between. And then you have alerting. Well, everybody knows alerting. It's a message on your phone, whatever. But even the traffic light, that's alert. Yes, you have to stop here. So a bit more about monitoring and the way we set up monitoring. For monitoring, we used Paisler, PRTG. Is anyone familiar with the tool? Paisler? One? Okay, thank you. So we have the virtual machine, and this virtual machine actually represents all machines. So it's not one machine. This goes for every machine we have in the system. So we call system stats, the connectivity, bandwidth, and certificates. And for that, we have used the SNMP and WMI traps that are actually on each system available. So with that, we collect that information. For the system stats, we do an aggregation into the system and send it over to Paisler. Same goes for connectivity, bandwidth, and certificates. Paisler also lets us check the connectivity to the outside, but also from the outside in, because we have probes somewhere on the internet that is checking our systems as well. Bandwidth, well, checks once in a while how much bandwidth is available, no congestions, jittering, everything measured there. And we also use it for our certificates. It's HTTP, well, HTTP is almost forbidden nowadays. So we have to have certificates in place, and we also monitor the time the certificates are still valid. And that's why we use Paisler as well. So we get a nice message 3 months in advance. Hey, watch out, your certificate is going out of license and get it replaced. With Paisler, we send it to a nice dashboard, or we use it for alerting. And for alerting, we use different systems. We use SMS. We still have the old pagers, even as a telco, sorry. And sometimes you just have to use a phone to get people awake and do actually something. So that's here. So you have your notification. People are coming into action. And those people are also looking at the dashboard. OK, what's going on? Is it just one system down or even a chain of things that goes down? This is an example of a Paisler dashboard with one of the errors in it. And you can see here the red stream, it goes from the outside in. The system here has an error, and it all flows through the whole system and indicates that something is going wrong within the system. You also have a nice overview of things happening in time. So that's on your on the left side. Past 10 hours, humidity, for example. But you can have things like bandwidth, throttling, you name it. There's about 50 sensors available in the system. And currently we have, it's not in this picture, but the other, we have about 170 sensors monitoring our system now. And it's just that system that you earlier saw. It's, 16 machines. And 170 sensors. It's quite a lot, but it gives us a lot of insight into in the platform. So a bit more about logging. Logging, I think, is the most boring thing we have, because it just works. It's collecting data from the virtual machine again. From the virtual machine, it goes into log files. We have our syslog working there, and from our syslog, it moves over to a local aggregation hub. And from there, we have to send it to a central log server, where everything is gathered. It's all flows in a big data lake, and some Splunk and other applications are looking into that data. We also look at this data, and the local log aggregation, that's where we hook in. But you can see that in a later image. And tracing, yeah. Like you see here, the failed attempts. The failed attempt, if you still use the same metaphor, that could be the spots where we didn't measure anything. Well, you can see like there. Failed attempts, we missed some data there, so we don't know what's going on. Well, I didn't drown, actually I came back, but the system didn't get the information right. So what did we try? We use Apigee, and we try to monitor the API flows. So we put in some the developer put in some nice JSON, and it was a kind of complex JSON file. And we tried to get that out into our, Kibana, we tried. And it goes through Fluentd, Elastic, Kibana, and we even tried InfluxDB and Grafana. But it failed. It's just too complex. So the backend system couldn't handle this type of data, and it couldn't be raveled apart, because sometimes it has this structure, other times that structure, and it was a real pain. So not recommended. Instead, keep messages simple and keep them flowing through the system, and do understand what a time series database, like the InfluxDB and Elastic, are capable of. And as last, close the DevOps gap. So dev people, ops people, you need to talk about what's possible. The dev people have demands, and operation people can solve it in sometimes, but not always. It's also depending on the tools. So what we did actually are tracing now. Checking the time, yeah, good. So again, that virtual machine. Collect the system stats, process info, and the log files. We use Telegraph, that's just one stream. Telegraph collects the data, puts in InfluxDB, and from InfluxDB, you can do more. That in a moment. The log files, again, syslog, same image as you saw before. We use FileBleed there to unravel some of the data from the log files, and it's put in Elastic. And from Elastic and InfluxDB, we use Grafana to present a nice dashboard. Dashboard could be something like this. A lot of gorgeous things over time happening. Red flags, yellow flags, green flags. Totally customizable, but it gives you a lot of insight into the system. And next to the dashboard, we also have notifications. So we use Slack for this part. And it's a different type of notification as the Pacler system does, because these are less critical than the Pacler information. So it's out of memory. Well, it's an actual system message we have at the moment. Seems like a terrible thing, but it's not, because this is something happening just before a garbage collector kicks in, and then the memory turns back to normal. But we do want to know what's going on. So, for example, we have an Nginx data flow. This is an actual system data we have. Data flow goes from the Nginx, system stats, process info is monitored. We have log files for seeing who's logging into the system. Same flow with InfluxDB and Elastic, and then the dashboard. This is a dashboard, I think it was from Sunday, and where you see the real-time traffic going through your platform. Nice visualization, and you have, this is the name of the system, developer portal, Nginx accepts, active, handled, reading, requests, waiting, writing, all information you ever want of the system, you can get it out this way. And we also have the API management interface. Use some Python scripts to track all the data from the database that's stored, put it in InfluxDB, and then we put it into Grafana. This gave us some really insightful information because of the nature of the calls we received, and we tried to kind of experiment with all the data we had. And we could see that there were kind of unexpected things happening in the system that seemed like to be errors. And, one of the errors was actually an error just in the script that translated the data into an image. Okay, silly. But there was also data available that showed us a kind of an error rate on some APIs. And now we have to find out if that error rate is actually the real error rate, or if there's something going wrong in the flow with the system. That's what I meant with more data, more questions. We collect more data, but we also get more questions back for that. And we need time to investigate in what the real knowledge is that. So we are kind of, for a gamification thought, we have a lot of APIs and we have a lot of developers there working. So we're thinking about creating a nice dashboard where we have the API, the developer who built it, and then who's scoring best this month? Two developers in the room, hi. Do you like the idea or not?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Mm-hmm. But same goes for the operations people, by the way, because you can also see the dashboard is going to be shared throughout the whole team. So also the developers can see how well the operations team is performing. Oh, the memory is too high, someone is not looking at it. And then what's happened, the developers are calling us, hey guys, something going on, so please fix it. So I think we're going to have a lot of interaction soon to be coming. Okay, wrap up. You had five, still five or not? Okay, cool. Yes, from earlier this week.
Is a finger on it?
Sorry? No, it is. Oh, sorry. This is the KPN template. KPN. Yeah, sorry. It's not a fingerprint. Come on. What did the four pillars teach us? Monitoring. It's half the metrics alone is not enough. We just need more information. And as you saw with what we did with Pacler, we gathered a lot of information, and it's really, really helpful. Logging. It was required for security and other things, but we also used that stream to get extract extra data from it and put it into our dashboards. And then tracing. Tracing is really the hard part. It's a lot of steps within the system, and yet you try to monitor. And it's really hard to get the exact data out at the right point. So that's it's hard. And like I said before, keep the message flow simple, because the whole system and all the objects you're going through is quite hard. So keep the messages simple, and then you can fly through. Alerting. Slack for non-critical alerting is fine. For developers, for operations, for all little things you want to tell each other, a great application. But for the critical the alerting, that go through SMS, pages, or even phone. The observability lessons we have. Get a platform dashboard on screen. Yeah, big TV in the room where the dev people are or the ops people are, and let each other know what's going on in your system. Share that information, because it gives you insight, but also understanding of the other people in your team. Anti-pattern monitoring, everything. You don't want to know everything. Have to be selective of what you are collecting. Otherwise, you have so much data that you kind of drown in what you are collecting. And then you have the social and financial implication. If you collect too much, you are always collecting data, and you're never trying to improve your system. Yeah, you need that information to make your system better, but collecting is not a goal on itself. It's improving the system, continuous improvement of your platform. And the social implications, I was kind of making fun with our developers now on the gamification of the APIs, but it could have more consequences. Yes, you can turn it into a game, but you can also make it so, oh, this developer, ooh, he's not performing well. Well, maybe it's time to have a little chat. So beware of what you're collecting and what you're doing with the data. And for me, the unknown unknowns, that's where we started. To somewhat known unknowns, but you still have more questions. And that's what I tried to point out here. So from data to information, yes, a normal step. You get knowledge, but with that knowledge also come more questions. And with knowledge, you have to get more data. So it's kind of a vicious circle, and it takes a lot of time to figure out what to do and what not to do. And with that, I'm at the end of my presentation.
Thank you.
Kind of on time. Thank you.
We have time for one question. Yeah.
Roger Knowles Ericsson. You describe the data as being the metrics, but according to my definition, metrics is the result of processing on data. You take raw data from the system, from a packet core network, it does not yet represent metrics. It's only when you calculate it, average throughput or one of these many graph metrics, then you can talk about metrics.
Good point. Where you lead this? Maybe the definition was wrong, but it's I think it's hard to have a good understanding of what you're trying to achieve and make it understandable for all the people. So and monitoring and metrics.
Okay, maybe there's a thin line between the two. But it brings us to another observation. In a way, you could get metrics out of your system. There's tons of data which you collect from your network. For instance, take a packet core network. In order to be able to process it, you may want to do the processing of the data in a distributed manner and push certain processing actions down to the points where the data is generated.
Yeah.
So you get already some process data, then we talk about real metrics, and that you collect into a metric aggregation system. So just to prevent that you get a too high influx of data that you would never manage to process.
Yeah, I understand, but that's also a scalability problem. And in the system we are working now, we can handle the data fine, there's no problem, and we do a little bit of aggregation already within the system. Like for instance, the logging, it's stored locally on the system before it's sent off to the security center. Yeah. So it's happening already in the system, but that's too much for showing in this session now.
Okay, good, thanks.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Okay. Well, last quick question here. Really quick answer, please.
For the alert notifications, do you use your own API?
No. No, they go outside in a different system. You want to keep those things apart. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
But a good question, by the way.
Thank you very much, Albert. Thank you.
Thank you.